I want to thank Ms. Richardson and Dixon and Ms. Flint for inviting me and allowing me to come and speak with you. I'll tell you, I was wondering how I was going to start this off, but I got the perfect story because entering here is like entering Fort Knox or whatever. I was here an hour early. I only got here 20 minutes ago because I came in and they want me to lift my hood and my trunk and everything. And then the visitor's parking was full, so I had to park across the street. I got across the street, I tried to park one place, I backed out, I hit a car, so I had to get out. So if I need to be the proof positive that you can control your stress, I am trying to control my stress right now. So hopefully I'll be a living example of what you can do if you understand how stress affects you. So, how to achieve and maintain peak performance. They told me this was like a managerial meeting, but anyway, in the CDC, I want you guys to be at peak performance, you know, because my life and the life of the country and the world depends on some of the things that you do. So I want you to be at your best all the time. And what can happen is that stress, whether it's stress because of the difficult job that you have or the stress that is in your life, it can take you from this point where there's healthy tension and you're motivated and you're focused and you're really at your peak level. But this stress right here, the connection is that the further this stress goes over to the right, the more stress that is built up and accumulated, what can happen is you can go all the way over to this disease state where it goes to exhaustion, panic, anxiety and anger and burnout and breakdown. And we all know or understand what burnout can be. So the key is we want to talk about how to stay up here. Okay, how do you stay there? How do you stay focused when you get a little fatigued? How can you recuperate and get back to this point and not fall over to this point? Now, the problem is how do you know where you are? You know, where are you? Are you here? Are you here? Do I need to back up a little bit? If you have a team of people who are working for you, do you need to push them a little bit more and get them more motivated and focused, or do you need to lay off of them a little bit? So it would be nice to be able to know where you are in this curve. Now, a lot of times what happens is that stress level gets over here, and instead of you getting to your peak performance, a little bit of even healthy tension can immediately send you over to this panic and anxiety and anger. And that's what I was trying not to happen today, is that a little bit of tension didn't send me over to this panic point. But that's what happens when the stress level gets from this optimum stress to the stress overload, then you just a little bit of stress immediately gets you over to this panic stage. Now I know none of you are like this, but you probably have friends who are like that. And I know that you don't have a lot of stress in your life, but maybe this is something that you can go back and help your friends to deal with. But what we want to do is we want to be able to notice when do we get to this point and what do you do to get from here back to that peak performance. So everything that we keep talking about is stress. So what is stress? Well, in 2002, this article came out and said the disability caused by stress is just as great as the disability caused by workplace accidents or other common medical conditions such as hypertension, diabetes, arthritis. We present evidence that calls for early recognition of workplace stress. That's what we're talking about. How can we recognize it early? And for business to allocate more resources for stress management in the workplace. So here I am allocating resources for stress management in the workplace. So what is the impact of stress? 43% of adults suffer from stress-related adverse health effects. 75 to 90% of all visits to primary care physicians are for stress-related complaints or disorders. So look, 75 to 90% of the people who come to me, their disorder, their complaint has something to do with stress. So if I had 75 to 90% of my patients who had high blood pressure, don't you think that I should be an expert on high blood pressure? I should know all of the articles about high blood pressure. I should go to all the conferences about high blood pressure. So if 75 to 90% of all of my patients have stress-related complaints or disorders, I decided to become an expert in stress because I said I'll be right 75 to 90% of the time. You know, how often is your doctor right 75 to 90% of the time? And I dedicated my life to understanding stress and stress-related complaints and disorders because I like to be right, okay? And I'm only wrong 10 to 25% of the time. So I have focused on stress, and through practice through these 10 years, I have figured out that this statistic is correct. And I'm going to tell you, it's probably even more correct now since 9/11 and the financial crisis, because that was all in 2002, that article said 75 to 90%. So I think the world is more stressful than it was in 2002. Stress has been linked to all the leading causes of death, cardiovascular disease, cancer. You know, we talk about all these little vague symptoms that people have with stress, but I say that death is the ultimate symptom. You know, when the person dies, you know, hey, something was wrong with them. A lot of times you'll get passed over with some of your complaints. So we want to avoid death. That's what everybody's trying to avoid. An estimated 1 million workers are absent each day with stress-related complaints. Stress is responsible for more than 25 billion work days lost annually because of absenteeism. So the number one reason why people miss work is due to stress. So this affects our economy, it affects our gross national product. So our whole life is affected by stress. Want to know the impact of stress? You know, he's got no gray hair, all gray hair. You look at all the wrinkles and his skin looks bad, everything. I know he can't wait to get out of office. I understand that. And this is not just President Obama. This is Abraham Lincoln, you know, dealing with the Civil War. We all know what President Clinton had. I think all of y'all are old enough to remember President Clinton. And then, you know, good old George Bush, all right? So stress will age you. There's something called a telomere on the end of your DNA, and that telomere shortens, and the shorter the telomere, the shorter your life, and stress shortens telomeres. So, you know, a lot of these presidents, they look a lot better after they get out of office than when they finish their term. So the physical effects of stress. Stress affects every organ system in your body, and we'll understand this as we go along. But it affects your brain, so it gives you headaches, feelings of despair. It can cause memory problems, concentration problems, difficulty sleeping. We all kind of understand how stress affects that. But we may not understand how stress affects the skin, because your gut is affected so intensely by stress. When you can't detoxify yourself through your bowels, you'll detoxify yourself through your skin with breakouts and pimples and whatever. It affects your muscles with muscle aches and tension, especially in your neck and shoulders. Your heartbeat gets faster. Your stomach, you feel that knot in your stomach, get nausea, heartburn, weight gain. It increases your risk of diabetes, and you'll understand that in a minute, because it releases glucose in the blood and allows your blood sugar to go up and increase your risk of diabetes. It causes diarrhea and constipation. We all know when we get nervous, you know, we get the runs or whatever. So it affects your gut. It affects your reproductive system. Now, I'm trained as an OBGYN, and I would notice, and this is a fact, that when women are under stress, the periods become irregular. If they have a test, if they have a death in the family, the periods become irregular because stress disrupts the reproductive system. And your immune system is disrupted by stress, and your ability to fight off disease and even to prevent cancer is diminished when you're under stress. Right? So you go into the doctor with all of these problems. Oh, my stomach hurts, my head hurts, I'm breaking out. And what we usually do is we order a bunch of tests. Anybody been to the doctor with some vague? So we order a bunch of tests, all right? So you get all these lab reports, you go to lab, they suck out, you know, all of your blood, you're pale face by the time you get out of there. And if you know it or not, most of the time these labs will come back what? They'll come back normal. See, I asked that question, and it comes back normal, okay? And then after they do that, they'll send you off for a lot of these imaging tests. They'll send you for an ultrasound because you say you have palpitations. They want to make sure that your heart is working correctly. Then they send you for an MRI, and they're looking for an MRI to find out why she's so claustrophobic. So they said, we're going to put you in here and see if you have some. And that's kind of some of the crazy stuff that we do in medicine. We're going to put her in a closed plate space to see how claustrophobic she is, or why she's claustrophobic. So you get the MRIs, and then eventually somebody's going to stick something in you, either in your rectum or in your, you know, in your mouth, looking for ulcers and all. So all of those things happen. And then finally, to get you out of the office, they write you a prescription for something. Okay. So, but if you're going to write a prescription, you got to have something that you have diagnosed. And we have a lot of non-diagnoses. Because here's what happens: all of those tests are looking for whether or not you have a disease. And there's a wide space between having a disease and feeling healthy, okay? So because they haven't found the disease with all of the tests, they came up with these other diagnosis. Anybody know anybody who has chronic fatigue or heard of somebody who had chronic fatigue? Well, here's how you diagnose chronic fatigue. A patient has to come into the office and they have to tell the doctor, hey doctor, I am tired all the time. And then we tell the patient, because all the tests have been normal, say, well, you must have chronic fatigue. Let me ask you something, what does chronic mean? I didn't mean to wake you up. What does chronic mean? All the time, it's all the time. And what does fatigue mean? Tired. So you come into the doctor and say, I'm tired all the time, and the doctor says, you have chronic fatigue. What did he just do? He just told you what you just told them. So it's not telling you why are you tired all the time, it's just regurgitating what you said. Now, fibromyalgia, fibromyalgia means that this is a person who has pain in their muscles and joints. And so you seem to know somebody with fibromyalgia, okay? Well, so you say, hey, doc, all of my muscles and joints hurt, okay? You know what fibro means? That's fibrous tissue, that's a joint. Myo is Latin for muscle, and algae is muscle for pain. So you say, hey doc, all my muscles and joints hurt. And the doctor says, all your muscles and joints hurt. You want to know why all your muscles and joints hurt. So you come into the doctor and say, doctor, I'm depressed. And the doctor just adds an ION on it and say, you have depression. You want to know why you're depressed. You say, I can't concentrate. I can't concentrate at work. I can't focus on anything. I can't complete any project. Well, you have a deficit in your attention. Well, that's what I just told you. I can't concentrate. I can't remember anything. So irritable bowel. You have to come into the doctor and say, everything irritates my bowel. I have diarrhea. I have constipation. You want to know why your bowel is irritated. You're not asking them to just tell you what you told them. Okay? Now, so here's what happens. You go down this road of antidepressants. Because they can't find anything and you're having all these complaints, they say you must be depressed. And what antidepressants are for, I tell patients that antidepressants are to make you not feel so bad about how bad you feel. That's really pretty much all they do. And then that leads to more prescriptions. So when you go down this road, you see right here it says last exit before toll. There's no getting off of that road. Once you start down that prescription road, it's very hard to get off of that road. So the problem is, again, the doctor is trying to make sure you don't have a disease, and you're trying to tell the doctor, hey, I don't feel well. I'm not at my maximum potential. And so you get into this adversarial relationship with the doc because he says, hey, you're not sick, and then you keep saying, I'm not well. And the problem is both of you guys are correct. You're not well, and you're not sick. You're having problems right here. You're having signs and symptoms that if you don't do anything, you're going to get to this point. And in medicine, we bring you back for your yearly exam. Oh, you're fine. Oh, you got diabetes. Oh, you're fine. Oh, you got cancer. Oh, you're fine. Oh, you got high blood pressure. Well, there is a road to illness that if we did tests, and what I do now is what we call functional medicine, not disease-based medicine. I was taught at Emory, right up the street, and I won't tell you how many years ago, because when I say it, it makes me depressed to know how many years ago it has been. But up there, I was taught how to do disease testing and how to diagnose and treat diseases. And if you have a disease, or if you had a disease, I knew what to do. I was an OBGYN. So if you had a big fibroid, I knew how to cut it out. If you had a baby, I knew how to deliver it. If you had PMS, I knew how to do that. But now what I do is what we call functional medicine, is I want to look at how well people are functioning, and if they're not functioning here, now maybe if you're 70 years old, I can't get you to where you were at 20, but I want to get you at your maximal potential at 70 or at 60 or at 50 or at 40. And I don't know about you, but I'm in this baby boomer generation. And the baby boomers, they want to live as well as they can till they die. Baby boomers want to look good in the casket. Okay, that's how my generation is. Okay, so they want to look good and they want to just live and get hit by a truck at 90 and, you know, while they're out jogging. So people are looking to how can they perform at their maximum, not only at work, but at home with their family, at their social organizations, people want to live a long, fruitful life for as long as possible. Now, that's my generation. Some of you guys are in it. Is that not what we desire to do? Is to function. But, yeah. But you want to look good until and do well until you hit that point. I say we want to live until we die. My parents were in that we take prescription. You go to the doctor, you get a prescription, you don't question anything. And I saw my parents' lives deteriorate over the last 10 or 15 years of their life. And our generation doesn't want to do that. All right? So when we talk about stress, we're talking about two things. We're talking about fight or flight. Everybody's heard of that, fight or flight. But what you may not have heard about is the parasympathetic. That is your rest and digest. So what is supposed to happen is that when you have a stress, the sympathetic nervous system is supposed to push you into high gear. You're going to run away from that snake, or you're going to finish that project, you're going to do whatever. But then your parasympathetic nervous system to come in and help you to rest, to recover from that stress, and to help you to digest so that you can bring in the nutrients that you need to recover from the stress, to renew your energy, to replace cells that have been worn out. So what you want is you want balance. You want to have balance between the sympathetic, and you want to have balance with that rest and digest, the parasympathetic. So you have something that happens, take care of it, and then you pull back and relax, and you recover from it. Now, the problem is that our society loves stress. You know, you're judged on how well you can handle stress. How much can you do? How much multitasking can you do? And if you say that you need to rest, people look down on that. Oh, I need to take a break. I need to take a vacation. No, you actually do, but our society frowns upon that. So you have to take charge, and you have to understand this, and you have to know when you're being pushed too far. So these are all the things, what happens under stress. We all know that our pupils dilate, our mouth goes dry, our neck and shoulders, muscles get tense, our heart pumps faster, get chest pain, palpitations, muscle gets tense, we start to breathe fast. But these are some of the things that you don't know that are happening. Your brain gets your body ready for action, is ready for your muscles to run or fight. You get a lot of adrenaline, your blood pressure rises, glucose is put into the bloodstream so you have enough fuel to run or to fight. Your digestion slows down or ceases, and your sphincters close, and cortisol is released to depress the immune system. So what's supposed to happen is your body is built for acute stress. Hey, the snake is running after me. Oh, am I going to run from the snake, or am I going to chop that snake's head off? So you have the threat. You have the biological response. The adrenaline comes. You're able to lift up the car off of your kid's leg or whatever. And then you deal with that threat, and then you say, phew. It's just like what happened with me with trying to park. I hit the guy, I respond to the stress, and now I'm supposed to come and I'm supposed to relax. And the problem is I'm tense again because I got to speak in front of people, but I'm more relaxed than what I was when I was trying to, you know, get into this Fort Knox here with them asking me to lift my trunk up and all that. So now, but I am able to relax. I took the afternoon off from work. I'm going to go home. I'm going to relax because I had a stressful day. But here's the problem with chronic stress. You get the threat, you get the biological response, you get the continuing threat, so you continue to be in that fight or flight. And the problem is, it's not just the snake that's running after you, it's all the other things that are going on in your life, and that all, it creates the same response. So you get the continuing threat, where you're getting all this sympathetic activity and no parasympathetic activity, now you get the symptoms, and then that gets you over the curve into that disease state. So these are all the stressors. You have your job, and I know CDC doesn't stress you out, so we're not talking about that. We're not talking about the CDC, but you got bills. You've got life changes, you know, and I'm at that age where I've dealt with my parents passing away. You know, you have kids, I'm putting kids through college. I got an office, you know, that I'm trying to run. We have some other companies that we're going through. But then also, I see a lot of women who have a lot of issues right around menopause, because that life change is a stress. So you add the job and the bills and the life changes and the kids and the divorce that you went through, and then you got stepkids, and you got dealing with environmental stressors like pollution that you have to detoxify, relationship with your coworkers, you got lack of sleep, your own illness, the illness of your parents and your friends, you have fear, your perceived stress, poor nutrition. All of these are stressors, and they can lead to anxiety, hypertension, autoimmune diseases, all of it. Now, what happens is when you're under chronic stress, your body is thinking that something is happening right now. So it says, forget about long-term survival. So it says, we don't have time to worry about balancing hormones so you can reproduce. We got to get out of this stress right now. So why are we worried about having a baby? And your body says, hey, having a baby is a stress. So we don't want that. So we're going to shut down reproduction. We don't want to store energy. We want glucose in the bloodstream so you have enough energy to run and fight. So we're going to have insulin resistance, which is a precursor for diabetes. We don't want to waste energy by giving energy to all of the cells, because the thyroid is what controls the metabolic rate. So it actually slows down your thyroid so adrenaline can run everything. Okay, so if you're under stress, your thyroid doesn't work as well. So that's why when you're under stress, you can actually gain weight, and a lot of people put on thyroid medication primarily due to stress. It takes a lot of energy for you to break down food and to digest your food and absorb food. That's why I'm a little bit skeptical when people I'm at these lunch things, because you get sleepy because it takes a lot of energy. So when you're under stress, you shut down gut action, absorption, and breakdown of food because it takes so much energy. The other thing, you actually retain water, because if you are in a fight and you start to bleed, you want to have plenty of blood and fluid so that you is less likely going to bleed to death. The body says, why are we worried about a cancer 2 years from now? So a lot of the natural killer cells that fight off cancer, they are suppressed. And also your immune system starts not to work as well. You have autoimmune diseases like lupus because of stress. And then the last thing you're going to do when you're under stress is go to sleep. And when you have all these stressors that are around all the time, it puts you in that sympathetic mode all the time, so it leads to insomnia. So because long-term stress is put on the back burner, this is why you have all of these symptoms. Your brain doesn't work correctly, your skin is not working properly because your gut is not able to detoxify you well enough. You have all of this glucose going to your muscles and joints, thinking that you're getting ready to run a fight. And when you don't run a fight, that glucose makes lactic acid. You know what lactic acid is? Lactic acid is how you feel after you've worked out. So a lot of times when you're stressed, your muscles ache like you've been working all day, but it's because that glucose has been going to the muscles. You haven't been doing anything, so it turns into lactic acid. We know about your blood pressure increasing. We know that your stomach, you know, you get the pit in your stomach, you get the heartburn, you get the increased risk of diabetes because so much glucose is in the bloodstream, thinking that you're going to run and fight. You get the diarrhea because your gut kind of shuts down and can no longer break down food and absorb nutrients. We talked about the reproductive system and the immune system. So how do we balance out that sympathetic and parasympathetic? How do we not let this get the best of us? Well, see, when you're young, it's easy to stay in balance. You know, this guy's on a balance beam. He doesn't know that if he falls, he's going to hurt himself. They have plenty of reserve energy. And so kids, when they wake up, they're full of energy. But then they also have a great parasympathetic nervous system. When they go to sleep, they are asleep. You know, when kids go to sleep, you can run a marching band through their room, and they're still going to go to sleep because they have a great rest and digest system, and they have a great fight or flight system. And you know, when a baby, when you take the toy away from them, they cry for a minute, and then they go off and they just forget about it, okay? So this is what we would like to remain. We would like to be like that, have a great sympathetic nervous system, get up and go and have full energy, and then when you sleep, go into a deep sleep. But as you get older, maintaining balance is a lot tougher. You see, she's got calluses on her feet trying to stay on that balance beam. And what happens is that life will flip you upside down. But the key is, can you get back in balance? Okay? And as life goes on, you get more flips and twists and turns. See, I try to stay current. Anybody been looking at the Olympics? You know, I try to stay current. So everybody, you know, so isn't this how life feels? Now, maybe some of you aren't old enough. But see, I've had all those flips and twists and turns, trying to get into medical school, trying to start a practice, having kids, and, you know, trying to stay married and trying to, you know, it's all these things happen. But the key is, can you stick the landing? Isn't that the main thing in there? You go through all these flips. Can you sit there and not fall over? And go, so can you stick the landing? But sometimes, and I hate to pick on Gabby because they've been picking on her, but sometimes you feel like that. You know, is that you're just all out of balance, you're hanging on for dear life. But like any great Olympian, what you want to do is get back on that beam, okay? So we're going to talk about how do you get back on that beam, how do you resist or how do you, you know, withstand all of those flips and turns that life hits you with, and how do you hold on and get back on that beam? So again, where are you? How do you get back up there? All right. We talked about you should have allocation of resources for stress management. How many of you guys have been to a stress management course? Okay. So what do they do with stress management? I won't ask you, but here's the deal. It is very hard to manage things that you cannot measure. Okay? If you are managers here, it's very hard to manage people if you can't measure their performance. Is that correct? You have to have some measure. That's why you have those evaluations every 3 months or 6 months or whatever. You have to have measurements to say whether or not this person should be promoted or not promoted. So it's very difficult to manage things that you cannot measure. So for me to tell you to manage your stress, it's like saying you should manage your blood sugar. If you have diabetes and I tell you should manage your blood sugar, what do you have to measure? Your blood sugar. If I say you should manage your blood pressure, what do you have to do? What do we tell you to do? Go home and take your blood pressure and measure it so we can better manage it. So in order for me to tell you you should manage your stress better, I need to tell you how you can measure it. Okay, so let me show you. There's something called heart rate variability. It's a stress test. How many of you guys have kids? I hope you don't get enough. Okay, have kids. So you're the youngest looking like you. I don't know who raised their hand. You're close to it. So how many kids do you have? Three. Oh, you're an expert. Okay? So every time they brought you in to, you know, when you were pregnant, late in pregnancy, what did they do for the baby? They put a baby on a heart rate monitor. Now, I delivered babies for almost 20 years, so I know this. Put you on a heart rate monitor, and when you were in labor, they said, hey, look, we're looking to see whether or not the baby is under stress, okay? So it was looking for fetal heart rate variability to see if the baby was under stress. Now, the baby can't be worried about jobs and bills and all those things, so the stress means, was the baby physiologically in balance? Was it able to handle the stress of the contraction and being in the womb? Okay, so that's what we were looking for. So it was looking for heart rate variability. And what would happen is that if there was any kind of physiologic stress, it was going to increase the sympathetic nervous system. It was going to raise the baby's heart rate. Okay? And because anything that stimulates the sympathetic nervous system is going to increase heart rate, we could look at this. So do you remember seeing something like this? Anybody here say? So, and they would tell you that the more this jumped around, the better the baby is doing. Okay? Now the reason why is that the body is trying to stay in balance. And it sees that any imbalance, let's say your blood sugar is just a little bit out of balance, or if you're not getting enough blood to your left pinky toe or whatever, what happens is the sympathetic nervous system is supposed to see that, supposed to correct it, and then the parasympathetic nervous system comes in and says, oh, we got that problem solved. So what you want for the baby to be able to handle those little stressors, and this right here is contraction. Okay? So what should happen is that when you have this stress of a contraction, the sympathetic nervous system should raise the baby's heartbeat. It should handle the changes that need to get rid of or to get through this contraction, and then the heart rate should vary again. Okay? So heart rate variability tells me how well is the sympathetic nervous system and the parasympathetic nervous system working, and how well can you handle stress. Okay? Now, this is good heart rate variability. This is poor heart rate variability. You see how the heart rate went up? It was 150, now it's 160. And now when the baby has a contraction, the heartbeat goes down instead of up, and it happens after contraction. Now, this is what happened, is that if this continues and that baby is not able to handle that stress, those organ systems that I was talking about are going to start deteriorating, and the baby is going to have stress. And if I don't do something, if I don't change what is going on, or if I don't do a C-section to get that baby out of that stressful situation, I'm going to be in court for malpractice. So I made life and death decisions looking at heart rate variability to tell whether or not that baby was under too much stress and not going to be able to perform physiologically well afterward. And so you can do that same thing as an adult. This doesn't change when you're an adult. We can look at heart rate variability, and we can tell, is the body able to handle stress physiologically, and can it recover from it, or is the systems are going to start deteriorating? You understand that? You sure? So we can look at heart rate variability and measure stress and your ability to handle the stress. So this is good heart rate variability. This is saying that you can adjust to a stressful situation. This is poor heart rate variability. This means that you can't take care of the small issues. And if you can't take care of the small issues like your blood sugar and getting enough digestion in the gut, then what's going to happen is going to end up being a big issue, and that's what leads you to disease and illness. Okay, so we want to be able to intervene here. So what we do is we can measure the distances between heartbeats. If there's not much variation, that is bad. If there is a lot of variation, that is good. You see it's 0.93 seconds. So you can measure the distance. You can turn these lines 90 degrees. And what you can do is you can measure how much parasympathetic activity you have. This is the parasympathetic, it slows down the heartbeat. This goes over here. The sympathetic, you can measure that here. And now you can look at how much sympathetic and how much parasympathetic activity somebody has. So we can tell whether or not you're in balance or out of balance, okay? So it'll make more sense if I show you a case, all right? This is a 21-year-old female. She's not married, she has no children, she lives at home, no financial issues. No stress. She's 21. She's like that baby that we saw, just, kicking around on the balance beam. So this is a heart rate variability test that we do in the office. So we get a person to lie down, all right? When they're lying down, we hope that they're resting and digesting. So we measure the distance between the heartbeats. We turn them 90 degrees. So the long lines means that the parasympathetic nervous system is slowing down the heartbeat. But you also see these little short lines here. That means that the sympathetic nervous system is taking care of small little issues to make sure that the person is in balance and everything is working like it's supposed to, making these small little adjustments to make sure that everything is in balance. Then we get the patient to stand up and turn the lights on. So the body has to adjust to that stress of standing up. So the heart rate should go up, just like if the baby was having a contraction. So we want to see how quickly does your heart rate speed up so that the distance between the heartbeats gets shorter. And then how well do you adjust to the stress? And then even though you're standing up, how quickly do you go back into this resting state? Okay? Now, the other thing you can look at, this is how much parasympathetic activity you have. And this is something called total power. How much parasympathetic and how much sympathetic activity do you have? Her total power is 7,349. I want you to remember that number. Okay? This is the parasympathetic and this is the sympathetic. All right? This is a 23-year-old patient. She has fatigue, anxiety, insomnia, and mood swings. She did not have the energy to apply to school or to maintain relationships. She reported her symptoms as moderate to severe, and her mother was crying in the office because doctors had told her that her daughter needed to go on disability. There was really nothing they could do for her. So they did all the tests, there was nothing wrong. They said she's disabled. She can't work, she can't go to school. Well, this is her heart rate variability. Is that good or bad? That's bad. Remember the total power of the other girl who had no stress was 7,000? Her total power is 210. So she doesn't have the ability to get up and go, but you also have to have power to go to sleep. See, a lot of people say, I'm tired, and then they say, but I can't sleep. That doesn't make sense. You have to have power in the parasympathetic nervous system to turn the lights off in your brain so you can go to sleep. Okay? So this stress is keeping her from going to school and keeping her from doing all these things, also keeping her from sleeping. So she doesn't have any energy, but she can't sleep because she has no parasympathetic activity. And you see, when she stands up, her body doesn't even recognize it. So it's not taking care of small issues, and it's not even taking care of medium-sized issues. And if something doesn't happen, she's going to continue to deteriorate, and that's why they were saying just put her on disability. So can you imagine a 23-year-old being put on disability and living the rest of their life with this type of pattern? So this is the comparison. This is that 21-year-old who's doing fine. This is the 23-year-old who's about to be put on disability. Well, the problem is that total power, your autonomic nervous system works off of all these things called neurotransmitters. A lot of people have heard of serotonin because antidepressants work on serotonin. But you have these things called neurotransmitters, and neurotransmitters transmit messages in the nerve. There's norepinephrine, serotonin, and dopamine. So it controls how alert you are, if you have any compulsions or cravings, it controls your sex drive, how aggressive you are, how much attention you have, what your mood is, you have anxiety, can you control your impulses, pleasure, reward, so all of these neurotransmitters control how you think and how you feel, all right? And they are all made from proteins, the serotonin, Melatonin, people have heard of melatonin, it helps you to sleep. Dopamine and noradrenaline and GABA, all of these are parasympathetic. They help you to relax. But they're all made from proteins. But even if you have the proteins or if you eat the proteins, then what happens is you have to have enough stomach acid to break down the proteins to allow you to make these things called amino acids. I don't want to get too technical, but you have to have the precursors in order to make this. So you have to eat protein, you have to have all these vitamins and minerals, and you have to have stomach acid. Now, a lot of people are on antacid drugs. And recently there was many studies that show that popular heartburn drugs, ones that decrease stomach acid, can lead to dementia, 44% increased risk of dementia. The reason why is that if you decrease stomach acid, you can't make these amino acids so you can make these neurotransmitters so that your brain can transmit messages. Okay, so what we do when we see a low total power, we give people amino acids so that they can make all these neurotransmitters so that their parasympathetic nervous system can recover. And so what we see is that this is that same girl after 3 months of amino acids. You see her parasympathetic nervous system where it was flat down. You see that it's starting to recover here. And her total power went from 200 to 600. Now, that's still not great like 7,000, but it's three times what it was. And she had just come back from a trip to Chicago to see some of her friends. And her mother said that that would have been too anxiety provoking in the past. And also, you see when she stands up, her total power increased all the way up to 2,000. Now, this is after 6 months. See how much variability she has? And this is with amino acids. Okay? Now her total power is 2,046. Okay? So she goes from almost being on disability to now that she's reapplied to school. She's in photography school. She's at the cafe where she was going to be on disability and never go back to school. Okay? So I'm not patting myself on the back. I'm just telling you that if you understand stress and if you understand the process of how you got there, and how you recover, then there's a lot of things that you can do. But if you just wait until you have a disease, you're going to live a not maximal potential life for a long time. Now, this is a 21-year-old college student on antidepressants, and he has erectile dysfunction. Now, let me tell you, the only time men come to the doctor voluntarily is for this. Okay, that is an emergency. They can have a heart attack, they're like, oh, I'll be fine. This happens, it's a major emergency. I don't know, there's a lot of women in here, but I'm just telling you, that's how men, that's when they come. So anyway, I had treated his mother, and this guy was on antidepressants. He'd been on antidepressants since he was 14. And you say, wow, you know, and I'm showing you these young people because we're putting young people under a lot of stress, trying to get in the right kindergarten, trying to get into the right grade school, trying to get, and this guy was at Vanderbilt. So he's trying to get in the right college. So he's been on antidepressants since he was 14. And now he has erectile dysfunction. So his total power is 399. And he told me it's commonplace. Almost all of his friends are on antidepressants. So what antidepressants do, they will help your low level of neurotransmitters last longer, but they don't make more neurotransmitters. So the problem gets worse and worse, and you end up needing more and more antidepressants. That's why it's that long road of antidepressants. Okay. So what we did with him is we gave him amino acids, and we gave him this supplement called EasyCom that helps to rebuild a lot of those parasympathetic neurotransmitters. So now, this is 3 months later, his total power is up to 947. You see he's got more parasympathetic activity. He takes the amino acids and EasyCom, and I haven't gotten him to come back to do another one of these, but you can see his variability is a lot better, and everything works again, okay? Now, I'll show you why, because the results of about parasympathetic nervous system controls erection. So you have to have parasympathetic activity in order to have an erection, but you have sympathetic, that stimulates ejaculation. And this works the same in women. Women, in order to want to have sex, they have to be relaxed. Men, it's the same way, so they don't have performance anxiety. So that's heart rate variability. That's one way to measure stress. This is another way to measure stress. There's something called a bioimpedance analysis. Well, we put two little electrodes on your hand and two little electrodes on your feet. It sends a current of electricity through your body, and based on how much fat, how much muscle, how much fluid, and how much bone, it will either speed up that current or it'll slow it down. And you can look to see how does your biology impede that electrical current. You can analyze it, and you can tell what a person's body composition is. But the other thing you can do is tell something called your phase angle. Your phase angle looks at how many new cells do you have compared to how many old dying cells that you have. Your body is always trying to regenerate itself. The reason why you exfoliate your face is because you want to get rid of the dead cells and you want the new cells to come and look healthy and vibrant. The reason why you have a ring around the tub is because those cells are dying off, but your whole body is doing that. So you have to bring into the body what it needs to make new cells. So you can look at the phase angle because new cells conduct electricity differently from old cells. You can use something called the phase angle to see, are you building yourself up or are you breaking yourself down? And weight does not always indicate your health status, okay? This person, this is her body composition. She's 51% fat, she's 24 years old, she's overweight, no doubt about it. But her phase angle is 8.2. So that tells me that cellularly she's pretty healthy, she's overweight, this person, she doesn't have an underlying problem that's causing her weight problem. If we can help her with her diet and exercise, she's probably gonna do just fine. So because her phase angle is 8.2. Now this is a person who has a good body composition, only has 25% fat, where we would expect her to have about 23.6 or 24%. So her body composition is fine, but her phase angle is 4.5. That tells me that this patient is not healthy, okay? How do you treat that? Well, most of the time it's due to poor intake or poor absorption or utilization of nutrients. How do you improve your phase angle? You have to have adequate diet or adequate supplementation. You gotta eat the right food so that your body has what it needs to make new cells. And even if you eat the right foods, your body has to be able to break down the food. It has to have enough stomach acid. It has to have the right bacteria in the gut to break it down. So your phase angle is going to go down if you don't have the adequate diet, if you don't have adequate GI function, and you gotta give your body time to recover. If you don't sleep, it doesn't matter what you eat or what supplements you take, if your body doesn't have time to make new cells when you're asleep, it's not going to work. So if a patient comes in and tells me they can't sleep, that's my number one goal, is to get you to sleep. Because if I do anything for you, if you can't sleep and allow it to work and rebuild your body, it's not going to work, okay? So you have to have adequate diet, your gut has to work correctly, and you have to be able to sleep. We're doing good on that. This is the third test we do. Anybody heard of cortisol? Cortisol, the stress hormone. Well, cortisol is not all bad. Cortisol is what wakes you up in the morning, and it's what tells you to go to sleep at night. Cortisol mobilizes glucose so that you have the energy to do what you need to do during the day. So in the morning, it wakes you up. It gives you the energy during the day, and then at night, it can go down so that you can go to sleep. Now, this is set by the day-night cycle. So wherever you are in the country, wherever daytime is, your cortisol curve will set to that day-night cycle. Now, if you go out to California, for the first week or so, if you wake up at 7 o'clock here, you're going to wake up at 4 o'clock out there, because this is set based on Atlanta time. If you stay out there long enough, then you will readjust to California time. It'll move and shift, so you'll wake up at 7 o'clock out there. All right? Now, when you're under stress, cortisol goes up. Now, when you're under acute stress, it should go up and go back down. But when you have chronic stress, what will happen is that cortisol will go up and it will stay up, okay? Now, let's say you're in a stressful situation for a day or two, it's no problem, it'll go back down. But you've been in a stressful situation for months, your cortisol will go up and it will think that you have moved to stress California. So you went through this stressful situation for 2 or 3 months, your cortisol was up. Now the stressful situation is over, and your cortisol is stuck at that increased point. So that even though the stress is over, your cortisol is up, so you're still feeling anxious and you can't go to sleep at night, okay? So a lot of times what will happen is you've been taking care of parents, or you had a death in the family or whatever, and you've recovered from it. You've recovered grief-wise, but your body may not have recovered, right? So let me give you an example. What do you think? You think this guy is doing good? This is a guy. So this is where the normal is. It should look like this, okay? But this is like this. So do you think this guy sleeps okay? Okay, do you think he is calm during the day? This is a guy, he's a type A personality guy. So he started gaining weight. Now why did he gain weight? Because cortisol mobilizes glucose so he can run or fight. So he's pouring out all of this glucose, but he has a desk job. It's just a high-stress desk job. So he starts to gain weight. So then what he does, he starts to cycle to lose weight. So he starts out cycling 5 miles a week, and he goes up to cycling 20 miles a day. And he continues to gain weight, and he can't sleep. And why do I tell you all men come to the doctor? That's what brought him in. He was gaining weight, and he was okay dealing with that. But then that happened. So then what I told him, we did this test to prove to him that his cycling was going to kill him. He was over-exercising. So I got him to stop cycling, and we gave him the amino acids and all those things. And within a few weeks, I had his BIA in here where he started losing weight, and he started sleeping again, and everything started working again. But this is just to show you how this cortisol can cause all kinds of problems. And if you don't do something to try and correct it, it can cause long-lasting problems, and it'll end up causing disease and weight gain. And so these are all these elevated cortisols, people who got stuck in these elevated cortisols. So again, this person can't sleep, they're gaining weight, they're anxious during the day. This is another one. And then this is what you would call chronic fatigue. This person has no energy to do anything. She wakes up tired, and she doesn't have enough energy to even fall asleep. This is what we call, anybody heard of adrenal fatigue? Well, this is what doctors would call chronic fatigue. But what you can do is you can treat this, you can recover from this. You just don't have to walk around with a badge of chronic fatigue. If you know what is going on, you can rebuild this. And I'll show you how you do that. So what you want to do, so this is stress management. Great on that. You want to identify the stress and remove the stress, okay? And sometimes the stress is a job, sometimes the stress is a relationship, but sometimes the stress is a chronic inflammation. If you have a parasitic inflammation, if you have irregular glucose, if you have any type of physiologic stress, you want to identify that stress and remove it. And I'll show you that in a slide. The other thing you want to do is change how you respond to the stress. Is that don't let that boss get on your nerves. Try and take some deep breaths. Go out, if the body is thinking that you're gonna run a fight, go out and run a fight. That's why people are doing kickboxing and all those things, and it relaxes them. So change how you respond to the stress. You can meditate, you can pray. I don't know if you guys listen to Joel Osteen. I listen to Joel Osteen. He talks about, you know, how to respond to stress. Repair your body from the damage caused by the stress. If the gut is being damaged, you have to repair the gut with probiotics and glutamine and things like that. Repair the body from the damage caused by stress and prepare your body for future stress. So how do you eliminate the stress? So all of these stressors, chronic infections, pain, lack of sleep, dietary imbalances, excessive exercise, chronic inflammation, all of these you have to try and identify those and eliminate them. So there's tests you can do. There's tests we do in our office. You can look at heavy metal testing. And you can see how well the detoxification system is working. A lot of people have food sensitivities. How many people have heard of gluten sensitivity? A gluten sensitivity, a food sensitivity, can cause stress and cause your cortisol to go up. It can cause you to gain weight. It can cause you to be fatigued. It can cause you to be tired. So if there is a food sensitivity, you want to eliminate that food. There are dietary imbalances. If you're not eating enough of the nutrients, your body sees that as a stress. It can't rebuild itself. You can do a test called organic acid. I'll show you that in just a minute. Chronic inflammation, you can test your GI system to see if there's parasites. Something called C-reactive protein can show inflammation, SED rating, thermography. All those can show if inflammation is a problem, and you want to try and remove what is causing the inflammation. We know about how molds can cause chronic infection. Gingivitis, there's a lot of information about how gum disease can cause heart attack and early death, primarily because it's a chronic infection that's causing stress. And all the problems that go along with stress. Lack of sleep can be due to the lack of magnesium or not enough of the hormone called progesterone or adaptogens that I will talk about in just a minute, or not enough melatonin. Neurotransmitter imbalances, all of those circles that I showed you, if you don't have enough of one or too much of the other, it can cause a stress because it's an imbalance. Emotional strain, you can try and meditate, you can do biofeedback. And hormonal imbalances. I see a lot of patients when their hormones are out of balance, that's the kind of the tipping point that causes them to come in because of the stress. So there's things you can do to try and combat. If you have a lot of sympathetic activity, there's things like 5-HTP, these are all in some of the supplements that we use, to try and balance out the sympathetic nervous system being over stimulated. And then also to lower cortisol, that guy who had the high cortisol, you can use something called phosphorylated serine, and your body can recognize that that cortisol is too high and can bring it down. Anybody heard of adaptogens? Adaptogens are things like ginseng. Anybody heard of ginseng? Rhodiola, ashwagandha. All of those substances are used to help you to better adapt to stress. So what they do, they are non-toxic, they don't cause any problems, they produce a non-specific response in the body. So the person who had the low cortisol, that had chronic fatigue, you can give adaptogens and it'll bring that level up. And the person who had high cortisol, it'll bring that down. So it's called adaptogens. It will cause the cortisol to normalize, all right? Also, when you're under stress, you begin to deteriorate or you deplete your supply of all of these vitamins and minerals. So a lot of times you don't have the right nutrients in order to make new cells to build yourself up. And there's a test you can do called organic acids that can tell you which particular vitamins and minerals you're missing. A lot of times when you're missing a lot like this, we'll do IVs, we'll do nutritional IVs that have nutrients in it. And this is before and after. This person's energy level really increased. This person was using like spending like $400 a month on supplements, but the patient's gut wasn't working well, so he still had all of these deficiencies. So we gave him probiotics, but in the meantime, we gave a lot of these vitamins and minerals to the IV. It really got rid of all of those, and the patient was much better. So that's our little overview of stress, how you measure it, how you can treat it, and how you can stick the landing. So even though you're having all these twists and turns, if you know where you are, you can replenish your body with what it needs so that even though you go through all of this, you can still come up on top with the peak performance. You didn't think I could get through 75 slides in an hour, and I told you I could. So I had the stress of, because I sent her those, and she's like, 75 slides, I said, I've timed myself, I know it takes an hour. So you have any questions? And so I know some of you guys got to get back to work. A lot of the stuff that I talked about is in those handouts. It's kind of the condensed version. So you can look at it. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. That is the main thing that I use. Mm-hmm. They're not testing for amino acids. You have to do a special test for amino acids. This is what I tell you. Now you can test for amino acids. It costs you about $200-$300 to do that. Or if this is low, I know you need amino acids. And this is a test I can show you. If you go, there's an app called the Health Stress and Wellness app. So if you buy one of these little polar belts, you can do this test on your own. And you can see what the total power is and whatever. But this is really telling me, is the autonomic nervous system working? And if it's not, it's because you don't have the neurotransmitters. And if you don't have the neurotransmitters, it's because you don't have the amino acids to make the neurotransmitters. But all of those tests that you're having, it's not looking for amino acids. Because remember, low amino acids is not a disease. And we're taught to look for diseases. Okay, and because they're not testing, don't understand it. And there's nothing wrong with the doctors you go to. Okay, I just had an interest in this and really tried to understand it and go beyond this disease testing. But they are taught to do what I was taught to do. Okay, but yeah, that's not one of the tests that are routine tests. Some insurances do, some insurances don't. This is a test. Insurances really don't cover, but it's really not that expensive. Not a whole lot of doctors do it, but I will tell you, most people past 30 or 40 probably need a meal acid because their gut's probably not working right. They probably don't have enough stomach acid. As you get older, stomach acid automatically goes down. Okay, anybody over 40, their stomach acid has decreased. So it makes it harder for you to break down protein into amino acids. And that's why, you know, I told you that a lot of people on antacids, you've seen these commercials about Nexium and all those. Those are all to decrease stomach acid. But when you have heartburn, it's not because you have too much acid. It's really because you have too little acid. So you're looking puzzled. What happens is that when you have too little acid, the food stays in the stomach too long. okay? And what happens is it's trying to push the food down, okay, but it's not digested all the way. Well, it's harder to push the food that way than for it to go back up this way. So what happens is you get this regurgitation, reflux, because digestion is too slow, because the stomach acid is too low. So if you add acid, it actually enhances digestion and it gets rid of heartburn. When you decrease the acid, you really are causing the problem to be worse. You just don't feel it as much because there's less acid there. So what you really should do is be taking, there's something called butane hydrochloric, actually hydrochloric acid. But the easy way to do it is to either take digestive enzymes or have a little apple cider vinegar, put it in your water and drink it. It'll increase the acidity of your stomach and it'll get you off of Nexium and all that stuff. And Nexium, because you have low stomach acid, you see a lot of people with these low total powers and heart rate variability because it decreases their ability to make neurotransmitters. And that's why it's increased the risk of dementia. And see, the problem is we use a lot of drugs and they cause a lot of problems. But if you really understand how the body works and how the drug affects it, you can predict that. So when that came out, I'm like, yeah, of course it's going to increase the risk of dementia because it doesn't allow you to make neurotransmitters so your brain can work. And as you get older, your stomach acid is already down, so you don't need to take more, another medication that brings your stomach acid down even more. Okay, but I want you to understand that the drug companies are out to make money. They're not out to improve your health. Okay, I don't want to be too conspiracy theory here. Okay, but their job is to increase the value of their stock. So how do they do that? Get more and more people on medications and keep you on it for life. Okay, but if you help the body, if you help the body to work better, it'll work better. It'll do just fine. But if you cover up the problem with the medication and just get rid of the symptom, the body is going to continue to deteriorate. That's why you're going to need more and more and more and more medication. So what you do is say, okay, what's the cause of the problem? What went wrong in this little system that I need to try and replenish or replace or whatever? And it doesn't need to be replaced with a drug that came out 2 years ago. It needs to be replaced with whatever was there before, whatever that baby had when it was up, on the balance beam. You got to replace it with what you have, depleted yourself of with that baby had or that 10-year-old had. Okay? So that's how we look at, that's how somebody who's in functional medicine looks at medicine. What is the dysfunction? What caused the dysfunction? What did we use up or what did we not give enough of? Or what system did we screw up? Okay, let's rebuild that back up. Now, it works like a charm. Okay? I'm right on time.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor. Thank you so okay. Very much.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Okay.
So, mm-hmm.
Yeah. You can regenerate. To regenerate itself. That's right. And that's what I look at. That's my number one health mark that I'm looking at. Is that phase angle going up or is it going down? If it's going down, I haven't found the central problem. If it's going up, okay, we're good. We replace whatever we need to replace by starting to regenerate itself. Yeah, we should do that. Yep.